Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And please note that we have received apologies from Willie Coffey, Marie McNair, Mark Griffin and Annie Wells. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Now, turning to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the LCM for the Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill, we're joined in the room by Craig McLaren, who's the director of the Royal Town Planning Institute in Scotland, and we're joined remotely by Jim Miller, who's the chair of Heads of Planning Scotland, and Liz Hamilton, who's the head of planning at Homes for Scotland, and I warmly welcome you all to the meeting. And we've got just a few questions, so it might not take us that long this morning. And we're focusing particularly on the planning data aspect of the LCM. So I'd be interested to hear from you if you, from your perspective, was the handling of data by Scottish planning authorities an issue raised with the Scottish Government during the engagement that preceded the Planning Scotland Act 2019? And if so, at that point, what concerns did you highlight and how did the Scottish Government respond? And maybe I'll just start with you, Craig, because you're right here in the room.
I thought that might be the case. Well, thanks for the invitation to speak this morning. In terms of the 2019 Planning Act, I don't think we raised any issues particularly around the planning data. But we did highlight the potential that it had and the need to try and invest upon that. I think particularly the way in which we can use spatial data has got real applications, not just for planning, but for things across the whole of the public sector and the private sector as well. So we highlighted the importance of trying to invest in that. And we're fortunate at our TPI, we were lucky to be commissioned by the Scottish Government to do some research looking at the benefits of digital planning, which included spatial data within it, which went to support their business case for the new digital planning transformation strategy, which is now in place. And I think it's got a budget of around £35 million over 5 years. And certainly that digital planning transformation strategy, one of its five core missions is about trying to make sure we tackle or make the best of planning data and unlock the value of that data. So I think we're quite pleased that's happening. We're quite engaged within that digital transformation process and are keen to see it progress as quickly as we possibly can because of the potential it presents for us.
And just on that, so on the planning data, does that just cover the built environment? Or because I'm very interested in spatial planning and I feel like at the moment in Scotland, we really don't know, like, land use. So, you know, there's so many critical issues and things crunching up against each other. So biodiversity response, renewable energy, housing, all of those things kind of like all demand, making the same demand for similar spaces or the same space. So if we captured that data through this program that you've mentioned, would that start to help us understand how we could use our land in a more appropriate way?
Absolutely, I would think it could. Certainly some of the work we did recently was looking at a range of different policy objectives which Scottish Government had and how spatial data and a coherent, a trusted set of spatial data would actually help make that work, particularly if it's organised in a spatial way. And that spatial approach doesn't apply just to planning, it applies to lots of different things as well. And I know there was work done by, I think it was Improvement Service and the Royal Geographical Survey, which had a look at some of the spatial data for planning and said that, well, one of the conclusions was that the range was vast, and one of the issues is actually trying to see what the core elements are of that as well and how it joins up and how we can make it work together. So, yeah, absolutely, it's something which can help other aspects of sort of local government and Scottish Government as well.
That's great. And Liz, did you want to come in on anything related to that question about planning and asking the Scottish Government on that?
I don't think specifically Homes for Scotland raised issues with planning data, but what I would say is that anything that makes the system, you know, create standardisation or consistency of approach across local authorities should be seen as a thing. Anything that sort of increases our knowledge base of planning and spatial land use is also a good thing. So I think in the context of what's being proposed, I can see the positives in it, but without understanding the detail, it's hard to comment at this stage. And as Craig said, you know, we've already got our Scottish Digital Transformation that's underway, and it'd be interesting to see how that could take on sort of enhanced data provisions. But yeah, I don't think we made specific comments. We do, when we do see sort of data gaps across the planning system, but not necessarily all in spatial planning. I think there are opportunities to increase the knowledge base across all aspects of planning, to be honest. But again, you know, we just need to understand what the detail would be coming through this particular part of the bill.
Thanks very much. And Jim, did you want to come in on this?
I'd like to thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence. I think the bill referenced the Transforming Places Together, the Scottish Digital Strategy. HOPS, Heads of Planning Scotland, have been working closely with the Scottish Government on that digital strategy. We attend many meetings with them. We have our own recently set up subcommittee to look at that and deliver what has been stated as a world-class digital system. We fully endorse that and support that move forward. There's a requirement within that for local authorities to provide more of their data sets in an easy-to-use and consistent format. So on that basis, we support, in principle, this move. But I think, as Liz has just said, certainly the devil will be in the detail. And when you look at some of the explanatory notes with the bill, those questions are raised. You know, it's only certain data sets are going to be specified in terms of the bill. So why just certain ones and not all of them? There's a question in my mind, and maybe it's my regulatory planning background, of we could return data sets to applicants if they don't comply with the data standards. Does that mean invalidating an application, therefore delaying development? So these are maybe questions that could be easily answered, but in the notes that I've seen so far, there is some questions in my head.
Okay, thanks very much. That's already very useful information. I'm so glad that we're having this this conversation. I'm going to move over to Paul, and he's got a couple of questions. Paul McLaren.
Thank you, Mayor, and good morning, panel. I suppose the main reason we're here today, obviously, this is a legislative consent motion that's came before us, and this is obviously coming from the UK government. In terms of, I suppose, the principles behind it, is the processing of planning data something that would benefit from a GB-wide approach, given the differences in operation of the planning systems across the three nations? And you kind of almost touched on it, and I'm saying if there's, I suppose, the differences or benefit or hindrances. And Craig, I'll probably come to yourself, first of all, in that regard.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think it's difficult to tell, to be honest with you. As already has been said, there's very little detail on the provisions in the bill. So it doesn't say what the data standards will be. It doesn't provide any detail on the process which is to be undertaken to take them forward, other than the fact that UK government ministers will need to consult with Scottish ministers. There's no indication of timetable or for implementation. It doesn't talk about the stakeholders who have to be involved in the process, other than Scottish government and the UK government and the Welsh government. I would wonder if there's a role in there for the users of the planning system and the people who manage the planning system, Jim's members and Liz's members have been users of the system as well. And in many ways, it doesn't really define what planning data is. So I think there's still a bit of work to be done to provide some clarity as to what this could look like and what implications there would be.
Yeah. I think that's an important point, because I think that's obviously, as a committee, that's something that, you know, we have to take into cognizance. Jim and then Liz, just the same question on that. In regard, you know, probably feedback from your own members on this. Jim, yourself first.
Hey, it's me first. We don't deal much cross-border, but it does come up from time to time. Our current application in my own authority has been dealt with by agents from London, and there is that certain confusion between the different legislative requirements in terms of processing a plan application. So maybe there would be benefit across UK, but It'd be a very small business as far as my authority is concerned.
Tim, thanks for that. Liz, just on that point, I mean, obviously, some of your member organisations will trade both north and south of the border. Are you picking anything up from your members in that regard?
Not at the moment, Paul. I mean, the although, you know, you'll have the nationals who will operate sort of north and south, as you say, they will have different divisions, and they will, you know, they will know the system that they work in. Can I see benefits across the UK? I don't know. I can, without seeing the detail, it's so hard to answer that question, because we just don't know what those data provisions will be. Would it help businesses? It might. It might. I've not had any direct feedback from my members on that, but certainly the ones that work across the UK, yeah, it could help them. I'm not going to say it wouldn't, but again, it's just so hard to say at this stage without knowing what that data is going to be.
Yeah, Liz, thanks for that. I think there's obviously a theme coming across about lack of detail on that one. I just wanted to move slightly on, and Jim, I'll probably come back to yourself on the next question. It's about the current IT systems that are used by Scottish planning authorities in terms of their effectiveness. Are they a barrier? Do they support? Is there more work needing done in terms of that? Do you consider yourself that there's a significant investment needed in planning department IT to obviously try and move the system as quick as possible? But Jim, I'll probably come to yourself first of all, because obviously it's obviously with the local authority interest in that.
A long history, you might be covered with a great hair, a long history in dealing with planning digital systems, and was involved in the first one. But with working, as I said earlier, closely with the Scottish Government and their the digital strategy, we welcome, you know, the improvements that are coming forward. There will be investment required in back office systems to improve those. They're all getting a wee bit old, and I'm saying that twice now, so better watch what I'm saying. We're all getting a bit old. But I think there will be investment required, yeah. But the actual benefits that will flow from the new digital strategy are so welcome, and the sooner we can get them, the better. Recently, with the work of the Scottish Government, they've decided to phase the implementation of it, which again is welcome as well, rather than having it all delivered at one time. So it will give us time to actually get our head round and working with the new practices. But the other improvements and enhancements of existing systems, we're not expecting huge wholesale changes in terms of the interpretation and use of them.
Jim, thanks for that. Liz, just yourself, obviously, I mean, your members will be dealing with these local authorities on a daily basis, I would imagine. I don't know what your experience is of your members dealing with local authorities, particularly about the IT issue.
On the IT systems, Paul?
Yeah, particularly on that.
They're all different. I think that's probably the biggest issue. Some are better than others. I mean, I could probably point to three areas where, you know, IT is used in planning. One would be in planning applications. And every local authority is slightly different, albeit, you know, there is the sort of the e-planning system, but it's slightly different in the way that's used. So would it be beneficial to have that as a consistent approach? Yes. Is it beneficial to have it all online and digital? Yes, absolutely. Also, the way that local authorities publish local plans online varies significantly. You know, when you're looking at a spatial plan, it can be difficult to pull up some of these documents. It just depends which local authority you're looking at. The third area I was going to raise actually is where I think digitisation and sort of standardisation of data could be really useful, is in how local authorities work and publish their housing land audits. Because these documents are so critical to how we forecast and measure the delivery and effectiveness of housing sites. So I think there's three areas I can point to straight away where they are all slightly different within local authorities, the way they're dealt with. I say slightly, some are significantly different. And it, as a user of the system, it would be much better if they were consistent and they all operated in the way that they're intended. And I think, as Jim's pointing to, some of the systems maybe are getting a bit old. Use that word again.
No, Liz, thank you for that. And I know we've discussed about the housing land audits before, and I think that's a really, really important point for us to consider. Craig, yourself, just on the same question about where you see IT systems in Scotland. And
obviously, we're not at the coal face, but from where I'm sitting, I think it's an interesting picture. I think there's some successes. The e-development service has been really successful. The very large majority of planning applications now are processed online, or are sort of submitted online, I should say. I think that's some of the best figures across the UK. My impression is that there are different platforms, particularly in terms of development management, used across different local authorities. I think there's different providers. I think that there's also the issue with different local authorities having different lengths of contracts. So if you're trying to make these all fit into the one, it's quite a complex picture to try and pull together. There's some issues there, I think, with that. I think Scottish Government, through the Digital Transformation Strategy, is trying to work collaboratively with local authorities and others to try and make this work. One of the big issues I think we have with this is that although we are talking specifically about planning, quite often digital contracts are done at a corporate level, so they're not always just specifically for planning. And that attaches some significance to planning data as well. So we need to be aware of that these are often corporate decisions which are made, not just necessarily for the planning side of things as well. So that makes it even more complicated, as you can imagine, if you're trying to sort of bring everything together in one sort of coherent piece.
Okay, Craig, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. Now I'm going to bring Miles Briggs in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. A number of my questions have already been answered, but I wanted to go into some more detail with regards to software systems, because the UK government are mandating the use of particular software systems in England for planning authorities. And I wondered if you had any concerns about what that might mean in practical implications for Scottish planning authorities in the future. You've all touched upon this in terms of being able to communicate data, but I just wondered if there's any specifics there you wanted to raise with us.
In terms of software system, again, we don't know what they are. So it's very difficult to comment on whether they'd be useful or not. I think it's a difficult question to answer, to be honest with you. I think the issues I've mentioned around the way in which Scottish Government is trying to attempt to work collaboratively, I think is important. I think the idea of working collaboratively is really, really key to this. We need to make sure that the people who manage the system and the people who use the system, as well as national governments, can feed into this process as well. So I would certainly advocate for that approach to happen as much as we possibly can. As to systems, I'm not an expert on the actual software elements of these things, but as I say, we don't know what's planned, so it's difficult to comment on what would be useful and what wouldn't.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone else want to come in on that point, or in the dark as well, in terms of software system? Jim,
yeah. Yeah. Again, a reference made to the Transforming Places Together, the digital strategy. So that will deliver new software in terms of the operation by local authorities. But if you just look at the planning portal, if you're familiar with that, where you submit online applications, that's managed by the Scottish Government on behalf of all the authorities. If that's it's being delivered and enhanced by the Scottish Government through this new £35 million investment, it seems a bit obscure that could be changed by UK Parliament to some other software system, since that's already enhanced for development. So again, I'm afraid it's the don't knows that we're going to come back with exactly what's been asked. It seems it only applies to certain data sets, but why not others, as I said earlier.
Thank you for that. Is it your understanding that the same software providers provide this across the UK? So we're not talking about necessarily different providers being chosen separately. I asked that question because in former life on Health and Sport Committee, different NHS boards had chosen different IT systems, which meant that they couldn't communicate, and health IT in Scotland is so bad because of that. So I wondered, are the same providers basically doing this across the UK? So these systems should be compatible.
There is one main provider, I won't name in this committee, but I was surprised when Liz said earlier that the authorities have different systems, because my understanding, most use the same system. is for the back office, the records management system, and that's across the UK.
Thanks. And just finally, on a wider issue which you've all touched upon with the Scottish Digital Strategy, is there likely to be any local authorities who are doing something different, given the different contracts we've discussed this morning, how that sometimes stretches into other parts of local government IT systems? And do you think that genuinely is going to resolve this and have a single system which can communicate not just with government but potentially between local authorities as well?
I don't think it will happen, but I certainly think that's the ambition. I think the ambition is to, as I said earlier on, to work collaboratively with the different players involved to try and come up with some solutions. That might mean, and I'm making assumptions here, that there'll be some core things which are delivered across the piece and others which are done separately by different authorities. As I said earlier on, it's quite a difficult task because just the logistics of managing this and pulling it together to make it coherent is quite difficult and will take some time. But certainly we've done some research on behalf of Scottish Government looking at almost the preparedness of local authorities and planning authorities to embed digital planning. And one of the things that certainly came out of that was there was a real enthusiasm to take it forward. There was a feeling that it could help with effectiveness and efficiency. Mm-hmm. We could reinvest some resources in some of the more important things in the system as well. And people were up for it. I think there's still a bit of work to be done, if I'm being honest, about trying to make sure that everybody recognises the true potential and they don't just think in the here and now about how we process planning applications. It's things you've mentioned around how we join things up, particularly around data, because I personally think that could be the real game changer in helping us to have a much more effective system, to be honest with you, and a much more open, transparent and robust system as well.
Yeah. And does anyone else want to come in on that? Jim?
I think we make it clear, you know, the digital strategy embraces not just planning but building standards as well, so that it's across the development sector. And when I heard earlier from Liz about the local plans, it's also going to address the local development plans as well. So it's wider than just planning applications. It's across the whole development sector, regulated development sector for planning authorities. On HLAs, housing land audits, that's obviously dealt with by housing colleagues, but I see no reason why those data sets can't be brought into the same standardisation across the services.
No, that's helpful, and I'd hope that given the pressures on planning departments and also access to planning specialists, this might be an opportunity as well for maybe councils to start sharing some of this decision-making as well, and individuals which are in high demand around planning, so there's maybe opportunities there.
It's an important point, because timing is an issue here as well. As I said earlier, the digital strategy is now being phased, which gives the authorities time to embrace those changes. If these data standards are going to come in, you know, the next year or so, then there's a huge resource issue for us to amend our standards to comply with those legislations. But if it's going to be over a period of time, then it gives us time to actually bring them in.
Yeah, thank you. Craig, yeah, sorry.
But just going to say something similar to what Jim said, that certainly some of the work we've done with planning authorities and others, the resource issue is still big. You'll know the figures about the problems we have in terms of the poor state of resourcing and the planning system just now. I've quoted in this committee before, 32% of planning officers have been lost since 2009, 40% of budget has been lost. That's not get much better, to be honest with you. One of the things that's come out from us in talking to people involved in the system about embedding digital planning is the resourcing issue, because this will have a change management aspect to it, and that change management itself takes time and resource, and there's a feeling that planning authorities are already sort of on their knees in terms of resources. There's more demands being put upon them through the Planning Act. There's going to be a further demand for more planning officers, according to some research we've done by Skills Development Scotland, another 700 planners over the next 10 to 15 years. So we need to handle it carefully and make sure the resources are there. And that's just people for change management, but also ensuring we have people with the skills to work with these digital applications as well.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks very much. I just have one other question, which is about that we've got the National Planning Framework 4. It's in draft. We're going to be getting to see it hopefully anytime soon. And I just wonder, you know, that's a big piece of work that's going to give us a set the direction for the next 10 years. And I just wonder if we've got this levelling up and regeneration bill and this piece of legislation coming in that's going to making some dictation around planning and gathering data and all that. Do you think there might be any impact on our national planning framework in that regard, or any other things that we're doing in Scotland in terms of planning?
I think we have a position just now where Scottish Government are moving ahead at a relative speed of knots into taking forward both the national planning framework and the digital planning transformation strategy as well. There's been quite a lot of work going on in that around data as well. I know there's been subgroups set up to try and look at this. We've been to look at how we can clean the data, how we can store the data, how we can make it accessible, and how it can be used interoperable. It can be interoperable across different aspects of local government as well. So, and I think that for me that the digital aspects of the National Planning Framework can be really interesting and, again, really quite game-changing. I'm thinking particularly around any delivery plan that comes with the National Planning Framework, having something which is almost like a live tool, which lets us know where we are, which gives us the evidence to what progress has been made against ambitions. I think that could be really quite powerful. So I would want to lose that.
Thanks. And anyone else want to come in on NPF4 aspects? Liz, and then Jim.
Yeah, I mean, what I was going to say is that with NPF4 coming in, and that has, you know, with the delays around that, what we don't need is another period of uncertainty and hiatus in our system. So we need to be careful. There are new or planning data regulations coming in, how we deal with that. So at the moment, we're not even clear how NPF4 will be transitioned into our system, causing a large amount of concern for our members, in particular in terms of life planning applications and upcoming planning applications. But yeah, there are opportunities in there, certainly, in terms of using planning data. And I know it's been raised in the committee previously about how NPF4 is then measured annually in terms of metrics. So, you know, is it delivering? Is it doing what it needs to do? So there's definitely opportunities on the digital side and the data side, and it's just how they merge, how that transition is dealt with to make sure that the system keeps moving in the right direction.
Thanks for that. And Jim?
I think we've already talked about timing, we've talked about resources, and it's all coming to a head. Through new fault, it's all been delayed because of COVID restrictions in terms of the officers, but it's all come together very much at the same time. I think it's been raised previously with you, the skill sets required for some of the new policies that are coming through NPF4, which will then embed in LDPs, has been a concern for heads of planning, and how to upskill the staff to deal with the certain aspects of that. So it seems as though, you know, we're heading into quite a busy time for all of us, which again touches on the timing and the resources that Craig's referred to as well.
Thanks for that. Yes, we need to get busy with finding our 700 new planners. I think that's our questions. If anyone, I just want to open it up and see if there's anything else you feel needs to be said in this conversation at this time. Nothing from Craig. We just need to wait and see. It sounds to me like what we need is a bit more detail, and then we can actually take it further. But I think it's been really important to just flag the issue up and note that this is potentially coming our way and the impact. So it's been really helpful to hear your perspectives. So thanks very much for joining us. And we now turn to agenda item 3, which is... Oh, what's that? Oh, yes. Where? Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay, so we're going to suspend briefly. So thanks so much for joining us, and we're going to just suspend briefly. Thank you. The final public item on our agenda today is to consider a negative instrument, Council Tax Exempt Dwelling Scotland Amendment No. 2, Order 2022, and this is a negative instrument, so there is no requirement for the committee to make any recommendation on it. Do any members have any comments on the instrument?
Just briefly, convener. Happy enough with the instrument. I'm a bit concerned in terms of the lack of data which is available for which councils this would apply to. So I don't know going forward if that's something we could request. Since the suspension of the Scottish Government super sponsor scheme, which councils are actually going to face a higher burden potentially of council tax not being collected. So I just wondered if that data is something we should also look towards trying to gather in the future.
Thanks, Miles. Okay, so is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations aside from to this instrument, but we'll gather that information that Miles has proposed? Yeah, I'm content. Okay. So we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the final items on our agenda in private. So as we have no more public business today, I now close the public part of the meeting.